afternoon. I'm Kelly Fedorik, senior counsel with Elias Defending Freedom. This morning, we're going to hear from Aaron Hawley, who just argued on behalf of Alliance for Hippocratic Medicine before the court this morning. We will then hear from Dr. Christina Francis, one of the clients in this case. And then we will hear from the Kansas Attorney General, Chris Kobach, after which we will take time for a few questions. Aaron?
Thank you so much. We should all agree that women deserve the ongoing in-person care of a doctor when taking high-risk drugs. But in 2016 and 2021, the FDA recklessly removed nearly every safeguard it had originally deemed necessary for the use of chemical abortion drugs, including in-person office visits to check for ectopic pregnancies, severe bleeding, and life-threatening infections. Without question, the FDA's actions have made taking chemical abortion drugs less safe. Today, I argued before the United States Supreme Court on behalf of doctors and medical associations who have witnessed these harms firsthand. The FDA violated federal law and its duty to keep women safe. It's particularly appalling if the FDA based its 2021 decision to remove that in-person visit on studies it acknowledged were, quote, not adequate. Women are now left to receive these drugs in the mail or at in their dorm room without ever having been checked by a doctor for life-threatening conditions. That's reckless. Yet the FDA attempts to argue that these drugs are safe, even as safe as Advil. That is simply false. The FDA's own label says that between 1 and 25% of women end up in the emergency room after taking mifepristone. That's not Advil. The FDA has shown a callous disregard for what women and girls experience when taking abortion drugs all alone. Every American should be deeply concerned by what the FDA has done. Women deserve better. Regardless of one's views about abortion, we should all agree that women's health matters. Women deserve for the FDA to do its job. They deserve the federal government to look out for their health and safety. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Dr. Christina Francis, and I'm a board-certified OBGYN who's practiced medicine for nearly two decades. I'm also the CEO of the American Association of Pro-Life Obstetricians and Gynecologists, one of the four medical associations that are plaintiffs in the case against the FDA that was argued before the court this morning. Regardless of one's views about abortion, we should all agree that women deserve to have a doctor's in-person, ongoing care when taking high-risk drugs. We should all agree that women's health matters. And we should all agree that the FDA's job is to keep people safe. But the FDA has violated its duty to women. After requiring critical safety standards for the use of chemical abortion drugs for 16 years, including the necessary in-person doctor visits to check for life-threatening conditions, the FDA tragically removed them without even adequately evaluating the impact on women's health. Its reckless actions have endangered the safety and well-being of women and girls across this country. My colleagues and I are on the front lines witnessing and treating the women harmed by the FDA's shameful actions. We knew we had no choice but to sue the FDA to hold it accountable. As physicians who care deeply about our patients, it is appalling that the FDA no longer requires doctors to provide in-person, ongoing care to women using high-risk drugs. These in-person doctor visits are vital to check women for ectopic pregnancies, severe bleeding, and life-threatening infections. No woman should ever be left to perform her own chemical abortion at home alone without even one in-person exam with a doctor. Yet that is precisely what the FDA has left women to face, despite its own label stating that roughly 1 in 25 women who take these drugs will end up in the emergency room. I hope that the U.S. Supreme Court will hold the FDA accountable for its reckless disregard for women's health and require it to reinstate these vital safeguards. Surely we can all agree that women deserve better. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Chris Kobach. I'm the Attorney General of the state of Kansas. It's my honor to be here representing not only my own state of Kansas, but also the other states that have intervened in this lawsuit as co-plaintiffs in the court below. The actions of the FDA here are not only injurious to the unborn with dangerous consequences to the mothers, but also they injure states' rights with dangerous consequences to our Constitution. In the wake of the Dobbs decision, the regulation of abortion was returned to the states where it originally rested under our Constitution, with the exception of the erroneous departure during the Roe era. But by unlawfully creating a system where abortion pills can be mailed to individuals in any one of the 50 states without a physician present, without an in-person doctor's appointment, and without any medical examinations afterward, regardless of what the state laws require, and regardless of the fact that that state may not allow abortion by mail, the FDA has overridden state laws with the stroke of a bureaucrat's pen. After the FDA's decision, in spite of the Dobbs ruling, private organizations started mailing abortion drugs into all 50 states in large quantities. In less than 1 month in the summer of 2023, seven U.S.-based providers mailed 3,500 doses of mifepristone into states that had banned the use of chemical abortions or had prohibited the distribution of those chemicals by mail. So let me make that clear. 3,500 cases that were violating state laws in less than 1 month. The FDA has radically interfered with state sovereign authority to set abortion policy. Indeed, the Dobbs court described abortion as one of the most profound issues of public policy. The court very clearly left it to the states to determine whether abortion would be permitted and under what circumstances. Each state, regardless of where they stand on this issue, each state has a sovereign interest in deciding that issue for itself and in compliance with the wishes of the people of that state. Abortion is one of those public policy areas that the court has very clearly said resides in the states. Our state legislatures determined that abortion drugs must be dispensed in person, not through mail. They had good reason for doing so. Chemical abortions not only result in far higher percentage of complications resulting in trips to the emergency room, but they also open the door to coerced abortions. Without a physician present, it is far easier for a boyfriend to coerce a woman to take the abortion pill or to slip it into her drink. But regardless, each state is free to make these decisions and assess the risks for itself. That is the essence of the Federalist model that is woven into our Constitution. The Founding Fathers never imagined that the federal government would interfere with the state's rights to regulate abortion, much less that an unelected agency of the federal government would basically sweep aside all of those laws that were so hotly debated in the state legislatures. That is why we states have intervened in this lawsuit. We stand with the physician plaintiffs here, but we also stand in defense of the constitutional authority of each state to decide these policy matters for itself. Thank you.
All right, we'll now take a couple of questions for Aaron.
Hi. So what do you say to members that are out here that are scared that they won't be able to access mifepristone?
So there's nothing in the lower court's ruling that would impede access. I think we should all agree that if women decide to use abortion drugs, they should be safe. The FDA's removal of in-person visits removes the best opportunity for a doctor to diagnose ectopic pregnancies or life-threatening conditions. It's simply unsafe to mail drugs to dorm rooms without women having seen a doctor.
Any other questions?
So the case today was about women's health. Do you think future cases could push the argument further so that the original briefing, all the issues that you raised, including the 2000 approval, which was already illegal, do you think that could be challenged in court following a favorable approval for this case?
So the Fifth Circuit found that determination untimely. So what the court is looking at today is, as you said, protections for women's health. So whether these drugs can be mailed across the country without ever having seen a doctor, whether the gestational age can rise, even though surgical intervention rates rise along with those gestational ages.
All right, thank you guys so much.